I believe very firmly that there are many ways to do things wrong, but only a few ways to do it right. And those few ways of doing it right are called best practices. So let's take a look at some best practices that are related to security. Now, there are many and probably hundreds or thousands of things that you should do related to your security. Some of them are common sense, some of them are not. Some of them are very technical, some of them are social. So I've kind of created a list of some of the ones that I find to be the most relevant or sometimes the least known that I believe are good security practices to implement in Azure deployment. First, remember what you are responsible for. Let's not assume that Microsoft is going to handle all security for us, depending on what you're deploying. You need to remember that if you are deploying a complete infrastructure and you are only using Microsoft's infrastructure as a service solution, then you are responsible for all of your software, security, configuration, deployment, operating system, data, and all of that security that's related to all of those components. So if you decide to use software as a service, well, that's great. You have much less components that you are responsible for to secure. But if you're using infrastructure as a service, you're responsible for a whole lot. So keep that in mind and ensure that you truly understand the components that you are responsible for and the components that Microsoft is responsible for when it comes to security. Use the security and compliance dashboards. There are reporting tools, there are configuration tools, there are settings, there are lots of different tasks that can be performed and objects that can be manipulated by using those dashboards. So I recommend that you use those dashboards frequently, especially the new dashboard. This is the one that is being updated more and more often, and that's the one that you're going to get a lot of benefits from. Now, talking about the dashboards, the reports. There are several reports that are available from that dashboard, and those reports are really key in performing some intrusion detection, in being able to see what type of attacks your infrastructure is suffering from, what are your vulnerabilities, or what are the vulnerabilities that are identified by attackers, and what are the ones that they are focusing on. As well, you can perform some great identity protection, where you can see the various suspicious activities that are running on your network. Maybe there are people that are logging on from geographies that have never been used in your organization before. Maybe you have no employees that are stationed in Europe, and yet from Estonia, you're getting 20 log-on, failed log-on attempts a day. So these are the type of information that you would receive or you would be able to review as part of the dashboard. Another great best practice that is really a new technological possibility or a new technical tool that's available in Azure is the temporary admin or privileged identity management, PIM. This is a technology that allows you to provide temporary access to an administrator to perform a high-level administrative task. So use that functionality. It's brand new in Azure, and I don't believe it's been implemented in Windows Server yet, and if it does, it probably will be in Windows Server 2016. This is a great functionality that removes the likelihood of having unnecessary privileges assigned to administrators. A DMZ or demilitarized zone perimeter network, those can still be very, very useful. And what do I mean by that? Well, many organizations believe that if they move to the cloud, they don't have an internal network anymore. Therefore, they don't need a perimeter network. Well, that is true that you don't have an internal network, but if you deploy multiple networks in Azure, they are, in essence, your networks. And therefore, a perimeter network can still have value. It can still benefit from the functionalities that it provides by providing that additional layer of separation, abstraction between the external public internet and your internal private network. Now, even though it is not internal, it is internal to your subscription and it is internal to your environment. And that layer of protection by implementing a perimeter network can still secure those resources that are on your internal network. So I do recommend that you still implement a perimeter network if you migrate your resources to Azure and you have a physical structure that is mimicked in the Azure networks to resemble the one that you had on premises. Protect your data in transit and at rest. So we talked about some of the encryption technologies that we can use to encrypt our data at rest, such as Azure Data Encryption, to encrypt your virtual machines, but you also have other solutions such as Azure SQL encryption to encrypt the SQL databases. There's lots of other solutions also to secure your physical files in Azure file storage. And there's lots of solutions that will provide that same level of encryption while in transit. So both encrypting our data in transit and at rest are very important tasks to perform if you're going to be storing and retrieving data from and sending data to Azure storage. Use RBAC effectively and appropriately is something that is both difficult, a challenge, and quite important. So RBAC, role-based access control, or role-based administrative control, depending on who you talk to, RBAC is the technology that allows you to provide granular permissions or privileges to administrators to perform specific tasks on specific objects. So you assign administrators to roles, and those roles have predefined privileges on a finite set of objects within your Azure subscription. So RBAC is truly a technology that is integrated in all of Microsoft's back office technology right now, Exchange servers, Skype for Business, SharePoint, etc. Windows Server use RBAC in order to assign privileges and provide administrative access. And RBAC is a principle and a technology that we also use as part of our Azure deployment. Now, the problem with RBAC is once you assign somebody to an RBAC role or you provide permissions, then those permissions may sometimes be more than what you really need. And that's why I say that you need to do it effectively and appropriately. Because if you assign your administrators to only what they need for only the scope that they needed, then you've minimized the amount of permissions that they have, the amount of administrative access that they have, and therefore you've minimized the attack surface. So that is both useful, important, and a complex task to perform because it is something that you need to evaluate properly as you're implementing it. RBAC is implemented through the user interface of the portals. All of the portals in Azure support that, but it can also be done by using PowerShell. Encrypt when you can, but really when you need it. So the fact that you can encrypt doesn't necessarily mean that you need to encrypt. So some environment or some of your data may not be as sensitive as others and may be secured just well enough the way that it is right now. Implementing encryption is not a simple task. It also adds a level of complexity to your network. There is always that balance between security and accessibility. If something is encrypted and you lose your decryption keys or you have some type of problems where you need to decrypt your data quickly, there's a certain level of expertise, knowledge, and practice that you need to have in order to be able to manage your encrypted data effectively. So make sure that you only encrypt the data that you need to encrypt, not just when you can encrypt. When using multi-factor authentication, be sure to train your help desk. This is a major shift for your users in terms of having multiple mechanisms that they need to use to authenticate. As well, this is an additional authentication layer that can block users out of your environment. So the help desk needs to be able to understand how to unblock users, how to provide temporary access to users, as well as they need to understand if a problem is occurring because of a multi-factor authentication problem, because of that secondary authentication, or if their a user logon problem is happening because they have an expired password. So your help desk needs to be trained, fully aware of how multi-factor authentication is implemented and how it works and how it can be fixed in the event of a problem. Now, what was true yesterday may not be true today, and this is something that is always true of Azure. The one thing constant is change, and Azure will constantly be changing and evolving, and Microsoft has committed to continuously evolving the Azure infrastructure, whether it be infrastructure as a service, platform as a service, or software as a service. Those three types of services will constantly be changing, adapting, and it's not because you configured one thing one way today that it will be the same way tomorrow. So always make sure that you test and evaluate the functionalities that you implement to ensure that they still work the same way. Microsoft is trying to do their best to notify customers and to provide change logs and constant communication as to how things are evolving and changing, but there is a lot that changes and you can easily miss some of those changes, even if Microsoft has done a good job at notifying their customers when those changes do occur. So make sure that you assume a certain level of change so that you can always be on your guard and ensure that you are ready in case a change may affect the way that you deploy your infrastructure.